Right, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining us today. So as part of our series of WebExes with Nuance, we are here today to talk about AutoStore. So we have Bob Pindar from Nuance. Bob is joining us today to talk about AutoStore in more detail, following on from his presentation to you guys back in July. But Bob, I shall hand over to you to talk about AutoStore.
Thank you, Fiona. Good morning, everybody. We also have on the line, though, supporting me, John Campbell-Higgins, who is the Business Development Manager for Workflow Solutions. John was with NSI AutoStore, so he has a wealth of knowledge. So I won't be embarrassed if he actually corrects me, and don't you, because he really knows the product inside out. So my objective, and hopefully this meets yours, is for you to get a bit more understanding of AutoStore, particularly the opportunities it has moving forward. It feels to me like I started in Safecom 10, 12 years ago when we started talking about secure print and pull print, and it was ready to take off, and it's taken off now. You can't really present that. It's about like presenting Word. AutoStore, workflow, security now, I really do believe it is the next thing that everybody needs to be talking about. I recently, one of my partners went into a customer, and you'd be amazed, due to GDPR, how it is focusing people's minds on the security of those workflows, but particularly how it can save time. So what we're looking at is all these workflows, whether it be document workflows, whether it be electronic workflows, and how, if they're inefficient, what that does. It wastes time. I'm going to ask you now to keep a figure in your head, and at the end of it, I'll explain a little bit more about where the figure came from. But that figure is 8 minutes. When you're talking to a customer, if you can identify a process, whether it be a paper one or electronic process, and we'll cover a little bit of those as we go through this presentation, that you think, you know, I could save them 8 minutes, then you've got a solution here that will cost justify itself. And that's just if one person can save 8 minutes in a week. It's all it is. Sorry, in a day. It's all it is. Okay. Obviously, when inefficiencies cost money, they create more risk. This organization I've been into recently with my partner is all about mitigating risk and what you do if there is a breach. Because the big thing about GDPR is not just the breach, is do you identify it in 72 hours? Can you find it? What it is, and can you correct it? If you have a warehouse full of folders and you don't know which one of the piece of paper is where that breach has occurred from, you basically can't hit that. And when we asked this organization what's their budget, there wasn't one. It was, we've got to fix this because the fines are so horrendous. Obviously, the quality damages morale, and I've talked about compromises compliance. But morale is also one that I personally have just witnessed. My youngest son has just started working in a financial organization. He does not expect to be shuffling pieces of paper. He has done a degree, he's done a master's. He didn't use paper. They do not expect paper to be used anymore. So it's your customers, those companies out there, they're being driven by their workforce to get up to speed and get up to date. So there's lots of reasons pushing them to do that. And you can find these inefficiencies all over the place in organizations. It's not difficult to go and find them. One on the top left, I think we're all very aware of, is, and I'm not going to go through all these, don't worry, is NHS. Lots of opportunities in the NHS where there's so much paper being stored, being filed, being retrieved, blah, blah. We've all seen them in hospitals. Then we've got lots of form filling, manual form filling, which has to be retyped. And we've got mobile workers. And then just the little one at the end there, just straight redaction. GDPR and personal identifiable information has accentuated the need for people to be able to redact. Even at a golf club with a membership form, they now need to redact, you know, that national insurance number or that telephone number or whatever it may be. So that in that one small space, you could find 8 minute savings if somebody could do that automatically without having to print that paper, put a black line over it, scan it back in again. So there's loads of areas to find this. And obviously it is the secure processes, passwords and what have you, is driving compliance. Now I will try, and I hope I'll succeed now, not to use GDPR one more time. So I've said it about 20 times already, so I think we all know about it. But that data at the bottom there, and you see it's referenced, 21% of data breaches are from hard copy. If you can get hard copy out of the system, immediately you're going to make people more compliant. So if you're going to get, a system that's going to help with workflows and, you know, with business processes, it's got to be able to link into what those major back-end systems are. So this is just a subset of them. And actually, as I was going through, as you do, looking at the presentation you're about to do, one at the end, their line of business, I was thinking, well, where's SAP? I can't see it anywhere. Well, it does. SAP has many different implementations, but it does link into many of them. And I know this because this is what I keep referring to, I've just been recently, is how they actually, this organization actually takes a piece of paper, takes an electronic input, prints that electronic input, takes data from it, puts it into SAP, and then files the piece of paper. Unbelievable. When what we're looking at, obviously, is just taking that through. So it is linked, and this is just a subset to all those major solutions at the back end. So that's a prereq if you're going to have a solution like this. And there's the big one, of course, with Microsoft and SharePoint, and it will link seamlessly into SharePoint. And there are businesses doing an awful lot of revenue on just now linking, helping people link those processes into SharePoint. It also has got to be able to integrate, as we say, in many ways. It's not just a piece of paper coming from a photocopier or a smart MFP, what we call them nowadays. It needs to be able to link into those smart devices, Android, iOS devices. It needs to be able to link into scanners, ISIS and Twain document scanners. Once again, in the health service, people like Brother, people like Epson are selling hundreds of thousands of these devices still. So there's absolute opportunities in the health service if you can take that scanner and instead of having to scan something, print it, do something with it, let's get rid of the middle bit, the print. You might even at some juncture even get rid of the first bit, but loads of opportunities. And also things are coming into companies electronically, which also got to come into these same workflows. So the solution you look at has got to be able to deal with all those inputs. Fairly obviously, it's got to be able to link to a wide range of hardware platforms on your smart MFPs. And we do, as you can see there, the range there, all the top major brands are there. You've also got to be able to create a solution that your users are going to be comfortable with using. So it's not that you're going to take them totally out of their comfort zone and ask them to start using this new solution, because they won't. And if they don't like it, they will break it. They'll find a way of breaking it. If they like it, they'll adapt to it and use it. So the little icon at the bottom there shows, so if somebody has a specific workflow and it looks like their workflow, they're going to use it a lot easier. Well, AutoStore, very, very adaptable at that front end, and to look consistent across the platforms. And that's quite important for the users. Then for yourselves, revenue opportunity. Once you find a workflow, to be able to create that workflow and then perhaps be able to create other workflows. So what we've done in the later versions of our products, and it's been with AutoStore a long time, is this drag and drop feature. So you're going to capture something, whether it be electronic file, whether it be a document. So you put the capturer there, in this case, it's an electronic document. And then I'm going to do something with it. Well, I'm going to read a barcode, or I'm going to OCR something that reference. And then I'm going to route it into whatever that backend system is. Now, what this solution will do, now, we have training for this on Nuance University, so it's lots of certification. We also do some office-based courses, which we run as well, so for people who already done the certification online. But what it is, it just makes it very, very simple and quick. And if you try to put together a workflow that wasn't logical, it'll stop you. So the key is it makes it nice and simple for you and get your guys to get trained, to get that extra revenue, but also to implement those extra workflows. Because our experience shows once a company gets the idea of workflow, they'll start finding other workflows. And all you got to do, that 8 minutes, remember, is one workflow. What if you've got two workflow? That 8 minutes now just came down to 4 minutes. And as you see at the end, my return on investment, how it can be, these things can generally be cost justified well within a year. If we start though with what the pain point is and what is creating that 8 minutes that you can get rid of. So what does it actually do? So first of all, it captures. It captures, as we said, from a variety of sources. It captures information, it captures emails coming in. It captures, in the case of the organization I'm looking at, the people send their orders in electronically into a hot folder, and they pick that folder up. So it captures scanning documents, electronic files, MFPs, smart devices, pictures, as we can look at a bit later. So it captures things, captures information at the beginning of this work process. It then processes it. And now we'll look at some of the processes it can just do as standard. As we move on, but once it's got that information, it does something with it, reads something from it, perhaps add some metadata that is either that's been put in at the front end, but it uses it to process that information and then links it through into a back-end system. And as we said, that system could be could just be an intelligent filing system. So now I've electronically filed. We have a university that has this system, which they got for their students. The students just quite simply scan something, stick it straight into their M drive. That's the basic use of what they do with it. But then the front office noticed they got some archiving they wanted to do. Not a warehouse full, but just generally in their office. Just created a workflow, electronic archiving, get rid of the paper. So as I said before, you will find if you can get people into how easy it is to develop, you will find other opportunities. So how does it work? So when you say how does it work, I mean, how do we build it? So first of all, you have AutoStore the product. So if you want to use an MFP or you want to bring things in from Exchange, like emails and what have you, then you buy a license of AutoStore. If you want to add smart devices to do that input into the solution, into that workflow, then you have to buy an element called Business Connect. If you want to buy Twain and ISIS documents, if you want to be able to link into those scanners, Twain ISIS documents, you buy a Quick Capture Pro. And then if you want to be able to get electronic forms coming into that workflow, for instance, just go onto a website, say a marketing application, go onto a website, you see a document, you think that'd be useful to put into this campaign I'm developing, right click it, bring it into the workflow, do whatever processes you need with it, and put it back into the back end. That's where electronic files can go to. Once you've done that, then we start doing some processes with it. You see on the right-hand side an example of some of the processes, and we'll go through what some of those can be. So first of all, image processing. So somebody's put four documents in, but just pretty randomly put them in to scan them in. It has the ability to then turn those documents around, remove things that you don't need, get it into an organized fashion. It can then take some of those images that are in there, say it's come from a camera, and do some auto correction on that image. So I've actually used this myself, where you've actually photographed something, then put it into a workflow, and it's then corrected it, with obviously without you seeing it, and then creates an OCR document. Which that OCR document could then be put through into the next process where you might want to search specific data, and then use that in the next process. It can take a document where it's been photographed at the wrong angle, same thing, correct it, then as we saw before, perhaps OCR that document, take off important information, and then that document now becomes useful to put into the back end, whatever that next part of the process is. One of the ones I always think here is an opportunity for this kind of process with the camera is for rental properties that got a problem, got a burst leak. Photographs, take the information, link in automatically to a workflow that says who's the renter, who's the rental with, who's the local plumber, all done locally. And bear in mind, the phone has GPS, it could almost pick up the address. So those kind of, if you think about those, if you're dealing with any state agents or what have you, are they still doing that manually? Easily find your 8 minutes a day with that one. Then after you've done the processing, done your OCR in, then you route it. Or you might want to take some data off that last form. So it has the zonal recognition. You can point it to where you can pick up the name and address, pick up what the specific number is, pick up down the bottom left, whatever that may be. Perhaps it was, it's not in this case, but it might be a national insurance number. And then you can use that data to go to the next stage to route it into whatever that backend system is that you want to route it into. Then there's other uses for it, a smart process application. I'll let you read that, I don't like reading slides. This is basically where groups of people already today are doing these processes, but where an implementation of AutoStore will make them much, much more effective. So let's take a couple of examples. Scanning to email. So if you're scanning to email today without a properly centrally managed solution like AutoStore, we all know most devices can now scan to email. You have some way of putting an email address in there and sending that document. If internally it'll probably get there, externally, unless it's part of the whitelist, it won't. most likely. Also, what it'll do is it'll scan that, and most users don't think of this, scan that document, which is now about 40 megabytes, and start pushing it through their email system, which really doesn't work very well either. So it's a very uncontrolled, unmanaged, and probably unsecure way of doing something, because you could, in theory, scan anything and send it out of the organization. Who knows? Because you're not looking at scans, or you don't have any history of it. However, if you scan to email with Nuance, then we have a totally different situation. For a start, we can centrally manage all those devices. Secondly, those devices can be linked to Exchange. So now we're picking up email addresses from our own email. So we've registered that device. So they know it's Bob Pindar sat at that device now, because I'm actually emailing from my own account. It just happens to be sat on an MFP. So it's centrally managed. Obviously, if it's on the network, you can optimize it. But more importantly, you have this security and compliance issue, just as you do in your own email solutions today. So when I send that email, we know it's gone from me. It's in my outbox. I can go and check that it's sent. If it's an email that was inappropriate, we've got the audit trail to see who sent that email, when, where, and to who. And if you actually want, which will be more of is the next session WebEx we're going to do on Output Manager, but we'll just touch on it. You could actually start looking at the content of those emails. And there's lots of other things you can do, particularly with email and other things with Output Manager, to go to that next level of security. But even within this area, we've now made that emailing much more secure. And what we do is we don't actually send that 20, 40 megabyte file through our email system. We send it to a folder and we send a link to the user. So now we've not clogged up Exchange. So it's a much better, more intuitive, secure way of working. That if you find a customer out there who is emailing things to themselves from the scanner to then email it onto somebody, you found more than 8 minutes. So you've just cost justified the license of AutoStore immediately. Send to folder. Once again, many devices nowadays are starting to send to folder, generally to your own folder. So you log on and you can send to your own folder. With AutoStore, we can take metadata, so one of the weaknesses there is random naming. And it's also either the folder must exist, or if you have got the capability of creating the folders on the fly, it's just random. There's no security around it, no processes around it to make sure they're named correctly. If you look at AutoStore, totally different. We can send a structured naming, just as if you're on your own PC. I can go into accounts, I can go into the customer name, perhaps I've got a date file, and put it exactly in the right place. And you can't put it anywhere else. We could take metadata from that document and on the fly create that dynamic file. Perhaps we look for the date, so we start creating our own date folders. And it has native support for Microsoft. So once again, a much more secure, compliant way of doing this than it is. Once again, if somebody's sending to folder and then moving on a second time, you found an 8 minute saving. You've found cost justification. This is really where we're looking at, and once it says at the bottom there, where you're looking and to use Output Manager as well as AutoStore. And this is what I touched on a second ago. This is where now we can actually start controlling what people are printing. And this day, you know, of compliance, and do I want anybody outside of HR to be able to print or email a national insurance number? If the answer is no, then I need to be able to track that. So there's the capability to be able to look at a document, look for that string of national insurance numbers, because we know what they all look like. And if that is tried to be scanned or printed, we can stop it. We can stop it going into the workflow, whether it just be an email out, what have you. But I say that's for the next session, more on the capabilities of Output Manager to do that next level of security. And then obviously, if you do find something that's not secure, you can stop it, or you can let it go through and also send a message to somebody else within the workflow. So once again, it's not just stopping something, it's making the company aware that something has happened, something they might not be happy with. And now we're looking at situations where we can start linking processes with automations. So this is what we're looking at here. This is an example of where we can take a document, basically electronically create that document, as opposed to it has to be physically created, and electronically being able to update that document. So let's just take a paper-based discharge of a patient compared to e-discharge, as we call it, electronically discharging that student. Anybody who came to our presentations the year before last in London will have seen it. See myself and Andy Morrison do a rather poor impersonation of this, but it's still valid though as a process. So we're going paper, you select the document, print it, in a secure fashion, no doubt. And then you've got to then take that document to that patient. That patient then got to fill it in. And unfortunately, with a family member, been through a lot of this recently. And every time you go there, they ask the guy, my father-in-law, who was poorly. So really didn't want to fill any forms in, having to manually fill forms in with his name and address again. Absolutely barking. So it really should be done as an e-discharge, as we call it here. So in this case, it's on an electronic iPad. Before they've done that, the nurse has scanned his arm badge. They all have arm badges on with barcodes. There's no need for that extra data. It says who he is. So obviously there'll be a bit secure to be the nurse roughly knowing who she's talking to, one would imagine, to make sure, yeah, that's the right patient. Yeah, that's fine. And then he can just sign it with his finger. Electronic discharge. Done. Everything up to date immediately. And then all straight into that back-end system, whereas that other document had to either be scanned back in or secondary retyping, therefore errors come into the system. Healthcare, without a doubt, is quite a huge opportunity. So this is just showing you how you then do the forms overlay and put the information into the form electronically if you want to print that form off. Okay, so once again, gaining control of a paper-based system, making it electronic. Just slightly conscious of time. So I've been banging on about this 8 minutes. Let me show you where this 8 minutes comes from. So if you take an administrative worker on about £10 an hour, so every time you increase that figure, then your ROI comes down. So we've just taken this to say, right, over 5 years, what would be required to cost justify one AutoStore? I've taken a price of £1,500. That is high. That is a high price. Depending on what you're going to do, but you can buy AutoStore Express, which is vastly cheaper. And if you just want redaction, I can do that redaction. You find somebody who's redacting, that figure comes down significantly. And what we're saying here is, but if you find one person who you can save 8 minutes a day, over 5 years, it'll cost justify it. It's rarely going to be one person. It's probably going to be two. That just halved it down to 2.5 years. As I said before, the reality is you tend to find these will cost justify themselves well inside a year. Because once you find a business process that is taking 8 minutes a day, there's never one person doing it. There's always more than one person doing it. And generally, if you think a device, the average is a device to 20 people. So if you have an office with 20 people in it and you find just that one redaction, you've now brought that down to 0.4 of a minute a day is all you've got to find, which is nothing. So these really are solutions. And then when you add on to that, you've made it faster, accurate, secure, and more compliant. So I'd encourage you when you're talking to your customers, just be looking for those. Don't be thinking about what AutoStore does. Be looking for their pain points and we'll help you figure out how AutoStore fixes that. But it absolutely has the solution that can do that. So I'd say that's just to get the point of, once again, I'm just mindful of time now. Once again, it is redaction is one of the basic ones I think is really going to start blowing because of this PII, personal identifiable information. If you notice, I've not used the four-letter acronym again. And these are just some stats that have been around for a long time. But when we talked about if you manually file a document, have to go and look for it, it'll take you forever. You'll cost justify one of these things in about 3 minutes. So all these things are reasons why people should be looking to automate and take paper out of their organization. And that's just a last slide. What I should put on there, and for you, it's extra revenue opportunities, without a doubt. Okay, Fiona, that's me done. If there's any questions out there.
Thanks, Bob. Just really wanted to say thank you very much for attending today. Bob, John, thank you very much for your time and for your presentation. So thank you all very much and I wish you all a very good day.
Thanks, Joe.